Hallo iedereen, welkom bij Dutch & Go. Today we're going to be talking about the NT2 exam, the spreken part of the exam. I'm not going to be giving you any other tips for reading or writing or listening. That's not this video. At some point I might do that too. But I feel like the thing that most students struggle a lot with is the spreken part. So I just decided to give you some general tips. Most of these tips are applicable for both program 1 and program 2. So yeah, no matter what exam that you do, I think you'll find these tips useful. However, I'm not going to be speaking specifically about tips for the 2-minute presentation that you have to do when you do the program 2 exam. If you haven't seen my previous video on the Staatsexamen and how it works, then check that one out first, because I think that will be tremendously helpful to be able to understand this video better. And yeah, let's go. Tip number one. Imagine what can go wrong where. What situations can arise where. And this is a very important tip, because a lot of the exam, both program 1 and program 2, put you into specific places and situations. And I think it's very helpful if you can imagine yourself in various places. And now we're talking about in the hotel, on the streets, in a park, at work, in the office specifically, at home, in the supermarket. When you go buy, for example, I don't know, like electronica products, etc. Things like that. Try to make a list of like different important places and locations in a European / Dutch society. And imagine what can go wrong there. So I've taken now here the example of a hotel. Well, I'll just read out a list of some issues that you can have in the hotel. In Dutch. De reservatie is geannuleerd. De kamer is niet opgeruimd. De bedden zijn niet opgemaakt. Er liggen te weinig kussens op het bed. Er komt geen warm water uit de kraan. Er is geen toiletpapier in de badkamer. De schakelaar werkt niet. Er is haar in het doucheputje. De badkamer is niet schoon. Etc, etc, etc. Try to compile a list and really imagine, okay, you go to a hotel, what can be wrong? What can go wrong? And then also, as you practice and make these lists and just practice the various vocabulary associated to that, then also maybe practice, okay, how would I react to that? What would I say to the receptionist? How would I explain the problem? I think that will be tremendously helpful to, you know, understand the exercise is better, and also what you're supposed to say and do, and be a bit more prepared for that. Tip number two. Think about specific phrases that you can use, or specific things that you can do for certain types of social situations. I'll give you some examples. So for example, when you want to organize a party, what are the things that you have to do? And I'm not now talking about the most extravagant of parties. I'm just talking about a regular, you know, 9-to-5 job kind of like party that you would organize with your colleagues. So what needs to happen? And do you have any creative ideas in order to organize that party? Such as, what can we do? Een taart bestellen. Kaarsjes kopen, hè? Want we moeten de kaarsjes uitblazen. Ja? Misschien een karaoke apparaat huren, want dat kan leuk zijn voor een feestje. De vergaderzaal versieren. Een pizza bestellen. Misschien een leuke film kiezen die je dan samen bekijkt. Misschien een playlist op Spotify maken. Of een leuke muzieklijst samen maken met je collega's. Etcetera, etcetera. Try to imagine, okay, so I want to organize a party at work. What are my options? What can I do? What do I need to buy? What needs to be organized? Some other situations. Some other frequent social situations. Such as, it's someone's birthday. Someone is retiring or has just been hired. What do you say? What do you do with that person? Do you give him a gift? You want to buy your boss a gift. You want to buy your best friend a gift. You want to buy your colleague a gift. What would you buy for them? Try to imagine, like, okay, you want to buy a gift for your boss. What kind of gift would you like? Would you give him? Would that more be like maybe a nice fancy Japanese whiskey and cigar? I'm not thinking cliche here, but I think that's, you know, the right kind of avenue to walk down, basically. Or if I'm just buying a gift for a colleague, then maybe that's just a nice concert ticket for Justin Bieber. I don't know. But all I'm... Concerts. Hey, we remember concerts. But all I'm saying is giving... Try to imagine what it is that you're going to do for specific types of social situations. Your company is organizing a little day trip. The school is organizing a day trip. Maybe they want your opinion. Where can you go to? What can you do together? What can you organize? You want to improve the atmosphere and social cohesiveness in the workspace. What can you do? What kind of events can you organize? Try to think about it like that. Which kind of gifts are good for men? Which kind of gifts are good for women? I personally don't like to think like that because I think, you know, we're all people. But anyway, I think thinking about it like this will help you tremendously for the exam, and we'll just make it a lot easier for you to just get in the right mindset. Tip number three, practice arguing. So a lot of the times the exam will want you to argue a certain point. When you practice the exam, just practice it by also arguing the contrary. So let me give you an example, I'll read this out. Je buurvrouw is zwanger en zij weet nog niet of ze na de geboorte van haar kindje thuis zal blijven of opnieuw met het werk zal beginnen. Zeg haar wat jij denkt en geef twee redenen. Okay, so it's clear what we're supposed to do. We have to tell our neighbor what we think that she should do after she has given birth to her child. What I would highly recommend is that you practice both situations. So I would practice situation where you recommend her to stay at home and come up with two arguments for that. And once you've done that sufficiently, do it again, but this time recommend to her that she should go back to work and give two arguments for that. Whenever you have an argument exercise and you're practicing at home, try to argue both ways always. That way you're just practicing your creativity to come up with different arguments and different reasonings. Tip number four. Study linking words. The exam always has specific types of exercises. Sometimes they'll want you to argue something. Sometimes they'll want you to give like advantages and disadvantages. There are linking words related to that, and I would highly advise you to study them depending on which category. So for example, when it comes to advantages, disadvantages, voordelen, nadelen, you can use expressions such as van de ene kant, van de andere kant. Enerzijds, anderzijds. Niet alleen, maar ook. Bovendien. Maar. Hoewel. Etc. I'm not going to explain how all of these linking words work. That is a totally different video. But these are some linking words that you can use. Or, for example, when you want to argue, you can use linking words such as ten eerste, ten tweede, ten derde, ten slotte. You can end your argument, your argumentation with samengevat. Samengevat, I think, is a good one. Or you can give extra arguments with niet alleen, maar ook, or words like bovendien, daarnaast, en, ook. Simple sentences such as we mogen niet vergeten dat. We moeten eraan denken dat... Tip number five. This is just a general tip, something for you to always think about. You are in control. Okay, they might oblige you to use the language in a certain specific type of context or situation, but you are in control where you drive the car normally. So that means that if you have to give an argument, or if you have to give two arguments, if you have to reason for something, use what you know as vocabulary. Meaning, before you start talking, just see, okay, do I know where this road ends? Do I know where this path takes me? And am I gonna come across any words that I don't know yet? And if that's the case, can I just maybe come up with a different argument where I can use other vocabulary that I know instead of don'ts? So always try to train that you become aware of the vocabulary that you know and whether the argumentation that you're using and the reasonings that you're giving is related to vocabulary that you know. And you just don't come up with something and you go like, oh, but I can't say that, and then you hit a block. No, just check first, can I say that? And if you don't, try to come up with something else that you can actually say or explain in Dutch. There you go, samengevat. That was my short list of 5 tips, of 5 things that you should take into account when you want to do the NT2 spreken exam. I hope that this was helpful at all. Leave a comment in the comment box down below if you have any further questions or any other tips that I didn't mention in this video. I mean, basically, I would really need probably 2 or 3 more videos to give you more and more and more tips. But I think with these ones, I think you'll be able to tackle this whole element of creative thinking, that is to say, a specific type of creative thinking that this exam requires from you, and that depending on your background, context, work, study experience, you don't necessarily have. Not everyone knows what it's like to work in an office. Not everyone knows these kinds of things, is confronted with these kind of day-to-day activities. Not everyone has the skill to come up with these kind of ideas or suggestions. So I hope that way I've managed to help you a little bit to think creatively in the direction of the exam and get you in the right mindset. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe if you liked it, and leave a comment if you want to. Hit the bell as well so you're notified when I make new videos. Dankjewel voor het kijken. Succes met NT2 en tot de volgende keer. Dag!